place where Jesus rule and reign supreme, a place where we lift him up high. Glory be to God. A place where his name is higher than every other name. Hallelujah. Go ahead and clap your hands to the Lord this afternoon. I'm excited to be here another time to feast on the word. And as I'm staggering now and see people are coming in, strolling in, welcome Sister Novlet. You know, welcome Shaquita all the way from Texas. Welcome Francine, Sister Pulsine. Hallelujah. And people are just coming in and coming in and coming in. Sophie, welcome. You're not on video. Hallelujah. Q60. Tahira, you're not on video. But all the folks and folks that are on Facebook, welcome. And for those who are on Facebook, don't forget to hit the like button and the indicator that that will indicate when we're on live. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. In Mark 4, before we pray, just for a word of reflection, Jesus spoke a parable regarding the word of God. And Jesus said, there was a sower who was sowing seeds. Jesus said, some fell on the byway, some fell among thorns, some fell on stony ground, and some fell on good ground. The disciples were puzzled, and they asked him, said, Lord, what do you mean by this parable? And he said, the seed is the word of God. But one thing that really stood out in that in his explanation, and you find that in Mark 15. And Jesus said, those that fell on the wayside, he said something so profound. He said, immediately Satan snatched the word. Let me say that again. He said, the seed that fell, remember the seed is the word. And he said, the seeds that fell on the wayside, he said, those are the ones, immediately Satan come and he snatched the word. Satan is after the word. Satan is after the word. And the soil means your heart. Because when the word is spoken and are sown, it's sown in the heart of man, because the heart is the soil. Don't forget that. Hallelujah. The ones that fell amongst thorns, he said immediately it will take root for a while, but because of cares of the world, the word was choked out. Some fell on stony ground, did not take root. Hallelujah. So therefore it don't bear any fruit. And he said, those that fell on good soil, good ground, those are the ones that take root and bear fruit. So in the name of Jesus, I decree and declare tonight, hallelujah, that there will be no thorns on this platform, no stony ground, hallelujah. We rebuke the enemy that is after the word tonight. In the name of Jesus, we arrest every spirit, hallelujah, that will come and snatch the word out of the people's heart in the mighty name of Jesus. We said, Satan, you have no place on this platform. This is holy ground. We decree and declare that this place is holy. Lord, we pray tonight, oh God, that you curfew this atmosphere. Surround it with angels, God, in the name of Jesus. We decree and declare that there will be only good grounds. The word will fall on good ground and bear fruit 100-fold in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you tonight.
Amen.
As we gather here another time, Almighty God, to feast on the word. You are high and lifted up. You are high over the world. God, it does not matter what's going on. You are high above it. And we as your people, we humble ourselves tonight at your feet, Lord. Excited to be in your presence, because in your presence there's fullness of joy, and at your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So therefore, there's always a blessing in your presence, and we are excited. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go in the house of the Lord. Glory be to God. And we are glad, we are excited to be around this campfire another time, to tabernacle with you another time, to feast on your word another time. Lord, we thank you. We praise you.
Amen.
Tonight, let us decrease and you increase right now. In the mighty name of Jesus, hide the speaker tonight in the person of Bishop Kevin Peter. Lord, you be the hand and the glove, Lord, tonight. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray you speak through him, God, in the name of Jesus. Use him, Almighty God, tonight in the name of Jesus to deliver the Rhema word. Hallelujah. The infallible word, God, in the name of Jesus. The unchangeable word, the life-changing word tonight in the name of Jesus. We pray that shackles will be broken tonight. Walls will come down. Deliverance will take place. And above all, Almighty God, hallelujah, souls will be won. And if there's a prodigal son or a daughter online tonight, Lord God, and even after when we release this on the internet, Lord God, the word, Almighty God, will take root. And they will come home in the name of Jesus. Lord, search our hearts tonight, Lord God, as we prepare our hearts to hear your words, Lord. Hallelujah. Till the soil tonight, Lord. Trouble the waters tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray. We come to hear from you. We come to hear from you. If there's never a time we need a word from you, Lord, the time is now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, we lift up everything that will be said and done tonight. Let it be to your glory. Let it be to your likeness. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
We pray that lives will be changed tonight, God, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, Lord, Lord, we give you a, go ahead and praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Give him a wave offering. Say something to the King of Kings. Say something to your maker. Say something to your father tonight in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and say something to him.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Give him a praise. He's worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. He is worthy to be praised.
Amen.
Lord, you are high. Lord, you are lifted up tonight. God, we exalt you. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We exalt you, God, tonight.
Hallelujah.
Let every other name disappear tonight, Lord, in the name. Let every idols be shattered tonight, God, in the name of Jesus. We leave everything into the palm of your hands tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As I hand over this platform to my bishop, your bishop, my pastor, my prophet, your prophet. Make him feel welcome tonight in the mighty name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What a mighty God we serve. Amen. I am so blessed to have every one of you, I tell you, every one of you connected to this grace. I could see families together. I could see people, spouse together. I mean, it's a testimony. Instead of us fighting a spouse, rather we are together to drink from the well of salvation. Isn't that a blessing? The other day I was listening to the news and I heard this guy say there is a kind of research that was carried out, and they found out that many spouses are waiting for the courts to reopen so that they could file in their divorce. Come on, people, look at that. People are busy filing for divorce. You are even getting married the more. Isn't God wonderful? Come on, come on, come on. So that's why I said to you that this COVID-19, or whether they call it a lockdown or lock up or lock in or lock out, however the lock is coming, it's going to work for your good. In the name of Jesus, I want to especially welcome everyone watching via Facebook. You are our special guest, and I tell you the truth, we love you. Everybody put your hands together for them. This group of persons are partners on Facebook. You are blessed and you are lifted in the name of Jesus. And I know that Elohim will never leave you behind. God will always bring you forth to the place of blessing. And I mean, I feel this joy in my bowels. I feel this joy in my heart so much. Seeing everyone healthy and hearty. What a God we serve. Praise God. And before we go in, into what we have today, I know your ears are itching, what level of revelation we are going to be having today. But before we go in, I need us to pray just one prayer. One prayer. We're going to pray and ask the Lord and say, Father, let no power of darkness disadvantage us in any way. Let not the devil sabotage our feet in any way. There is some kind of revelation the Lord, showed to me. And the Lord said to me, let the church take charge. None of us will go down in the name of Jesus. Every power of darkness seeking to sabotage the faith we have proclaimed, every power of darkness seeking to sabotage the declarations of the Dunamis Palace, what we stand for, based on the book of Job chapter 5 verse 19. He said he shall deliver us from six troubles, and in seven, he said, no evil shall come close to our dwelling place. So you're going to open your mouth and say, Father, you have the ability to deliver me from six. You have the ability also to deliver me from the seventh attack. In the name of Jesus, open your mouth and pray, declare in the name of Jesus that your family, either here, home, or abroad, will never come under such spiritual and demonic sabotage, that no power will sabotage the good things and the prophetic declaration of protection that the Lord has put over you and your household. Somebody is not praying. Open your mouth and decree and declare. Say, Father, I will not come against such curse. I will not come against, oh Lord Jehovah, under such attack. In the name of Jesus, I abrogate, oh Lord, every decree, every demonic decree over my life, over my family, over all I do, in the name of Jesus. Somebody say, in Jesus' name, hear me. You will not be a victim this season, in the name of Jesus. I know what I'm talking about. Praise God. I may not give you the breakdown of everything, but you will never be a victim this season. Your family members will never be a victim this season. And also every evil decree. I tell you the truth. When a demonic prophecy is released over your head, if you do nothing and do not act upon it, is a sign that you have given a go ahead, that it should go ahead. Is a sign that you have said, yes, I agree with it. You know, we are going to pray nationwide, all over the globe. Every prophecy of second wave, every demonic prophecy of second wave of COVID-19. We are going to decree and say, Father, it shall not stand, neither shall it come to pass. We put a stop to every demonic prophecy against the world, against this nation of Canada, against Africa, against North America, against Asia. In the name of Jesus, there shall be no second wave. Father, Lord, we thwart the plans of the enemies. We frustrate the tokens of liars. And we command their diviners to go mad. By fire, by force, oh Lord Jehovah, we uproot in the name of Jesus every seed that has been sown. We disagree, oh Lord, with that verdict. In the name of Jesus, we command a total stop to that evil verdict. In the name of Jesus, and we decree, let it be abrogated. In the name of Jesus, may it come to a total stop. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout fire. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. I say, may your name be praised in the highest. Be thou glorified, O Lord. For in your presence, O Lord, there is fullness of joy. Right hand side, O Lord, there are pleasures forevermore. God, I thank you for such a day. And everyone, O Lord, you have given unto us, O Lord Jehovah. Father, none shall be missing. We will lose nobody in the name of Jesus. The glory of God will come upon you. You will never be a victim. I tell you the truth. Those that trust in the arms of the flesh, they will be disappointed. And an example of the arms of the flesh is when you trust that it is because of yourself that you are safe and secured. Then you will come to understand that it's not of him that will it. It is not of him that run it. It's of God that showeth mercy. That you are alive today, healthy and happy. It's not because you've never shook hands before with a COVID-19 patient that is positive and don't know that they are positive. It's not because you've not walked into a place that is so deadly and the environment is so toxic to the extent that many that walked in there too has fallen sick, but you haven't fallen sick. It's not because of your smartness. Am I talking to somebody? It is because of the grace of God. It is the favor of God. It's not because you are better than those that are in the hospital right now battling for their lives. It's not because you are better than those that are in the hospital or those that are dead. But his mercy has kept you. His mercy said no, that you are not going to be a victim. I tell you the truth. Some of us, if we are put in the scale of balance and be judged, we'll be found wanting like King Nebuchadnezzar. But his mercy has said no. His mercy has kept us. His mercy has kept your children. His mercy has kept your husband. His mercy has kept your wife. His mercy has kept everything that you stand for. And I come today to covenant with you. And I said that mercy will never, ever, ever, ever be sabotaged. In the name of Jesus, I come against every force of darkness. I come against every unwanted visitor called the name of coronavirus, COVID-19. It's an unwanted visitor, and we command it to be gone in the name of Jesus. The other day, oh my God, I feel like I'm preaching now. The other day, the Bible said that it's appointed unto man to die. So death is by appointment. Excuse me. I have the rights and the inalienable right to disappoint any appointment I don't want. I don't know of you, but I have disappointed the appointment of death. Death will never come close to my dwelling place. In the name of Jesus, my family is covered. Your family is covered. Your loved ones are covered. In the name of Jesus, somebody say, I hear you. So we have that ability. We have that power. It is not because you have some mask that look like or make you look like a Batman or a Superman. It's not because you have those masks like mine that sometimes when I go into a place and it's mandatory, which we have to obey the government, you know, to put on masks. Yesterday I was out with some lovely believers, praise God, and I was just so uncomfortable. That is what the enemy wants to do. Take away your peace of mind. Take away your joy. Take away your freedom. Take away things and put you in a place of limitation. Am I talking to somebody? But I come today to announce to you or to announce to somebody that is concerned about this whole thing that this evil has an expiring date. In the name of Jesus, I pray today. I don't know why I'm flowing like this, but I pray today that the expiring date, oh Lord, will force it to come to pass quicker. In the name of Jesus, we force the expiring date of this virus to come to pass even quicker. In the name of Jesus, whatever, we have the right, we have the power to decree a thing. The Bible says it shall be established. Am I talking to somebody? And the other day, I know that God is not looking for a group of persons to come together to decree. He's looking for just one man that can stand in the gap in the name of Jesus. So we join faith with other believers all over the globe, everywhere they are standing today, those that are willingly praying that this evil cloud must pass away. We join faith with them and we decree that this cloud of evil will pass away in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Jam those hands together and give God praise. In 1 second, thank God. Thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God. Thank God for your for coverage, for supernatural coverage. In the name of Jesus, thank God for giving you the ability to stand strong. We give God all the praise. Hallelujah. And I welcome you specially to another series of commanding generational blessings. Amen. Is somebody ready with his pen and paper, your jotter, your pencil, whatever it is? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And you have your Bible with you? Hallelujah. That is wonderful. Praise God. I'm seeing different sizes of Bibles. My God, big and small, bold and thin. But the Lord made them all. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I love this church. I love this family. I love this family. I love this family of God. Amen. We are too much. Hallelujah. We are too connected to be disconnected. We are too much to be frustrated. Am I communicating with somebody? No matter how it is, we decided that we want to stick to the word and not to stick with physical food. And we are healthy spiritually and physically. Am I communicating with somebody? I know that God has given you the ability and grace in the name of Jesus to come to the place of glory and testimony. I know that something big is about to happen to you in the name of Jesus. And I know there are testimonies rolling up left and right. Praise God. Praise God. Testimonies rolling up left and right. So today we're going to continue in our lovely, lovely series of commanding generational blessings. Generational blessings. Turn to your neighbor if you have one, or you tell yourself, you say, I am blessed. Even up to my fourth generation, we are blessed. Am I communicating with somebody? Yes. The blessings of the Lord, the Bible says, make it rich. Ha! Madara kadeada. It make it rich and added no sorrow. Somebody say, no sorrow. Yes, the blessings of the Lord make it rich and added no sorrow. So it is a covenant that when God blesses you, not if God blesses you, but when God blesses you, he will by himself take off sorrow from you. He will by himself liquid dry sorrow out of your life. Because you cannot be rejoicing and be eating the bread of sorrow at the same time. That is not scriptural. Am I communicating with somebody? Yes, you cannot be blessed by God and rejoicing. God cannot give you the ability to rejoice and at the same time give you the bread of sorrow to be eaten. That is not of God. Am I communicating? My God is a good God. Yes, he is. Amen. So today we are going to be looking at the curse of prophets. The curse of prophets. You can say men of God also, or servant of God. You can say the curse of prophet, or men of God, or servant of God. We dealt on certain powerful topic last week, Thursday, about the curse of elders. The curse of elders. And I mean, it blessed me so much. Praise God. Because it reaffirmed many things that, I am doing, even in my household, that someone may overlook. Praise God. It reaffirmed a lot of things for me. And I say this to you, that if your message has not blessed you first, that message is a suspect. Every message you preach or whatever you say to people, you must first of all have been able to test it first. The Bible says, test and see, for the Lord is what? for the Lord is good. Praise God. So you have the ability to test it. You have the grace to step in first and to tell people how wonderful and how beautiful it is. So we looked at it and we delved so deep, certain things that we think that it's okay to do it. And this via the scripture, we have seen it that look, for you to live long, for you to have long life on earth here, you cannot be someone that curses elders and expect the covenant and the blessings of God to be released upon you. Praise God. And I know as we concentrate so much and putting ears down to this communication, I know that God will be able today, God will deliver us from every darkness of knowledge that we were believing that such is right. So today we are, as I've said, we are looking at the cross of prophets. And the question is, who is the prophet? That's the $1 million question that many we want to ask. We know that as we understand that, you know, the office of a prophet is also there. We understand the fivefold ministry, praise God. But right now we're talking about the curse of the prophet. So who is a prophet? Now, I need you to follow me carefully. There are some scriptures I'm going to call out, but we are not going to read it. So you have to jot it down for your own consumption. Am I communicating? The prophet proclaimed the message given to him as the seer. Beheld the vision of God. See Numbers chapter 12, verse 6. Numbers chapter 12, verse 6 and Numbers chapter 12, verse 8. Thus, a prophet was a spokesman for God, meaning a prophet is a spokesman for God. He speaks on God's name and by his authority. So a prophet does not just speak, but he is a mouthpiece. He is a mouthpiece of God. He speaks in the name of God and also by the authority of God. Praise God. That also, the supporting scripture for it is Exodus chapter 7, verse 1. Exodus chapter 7, verse 1. Exodus chapter 7, verse 1. I go further. He is the mouth by which God speaks to men. Who is a prophet? He is the mouth by which God speaks to mankind. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 16. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9. And Isaiah chapter 51, verse 16. And hence, what the prophet says is not of man, but of God. You see that again? Whatsoever the prophet will say, is not of man. He may be man, but he has translated from being man to a messenger of God, The other day, Paul was speaking, he said, a messenger of Satan was sent. You know, so God's have messengers. Satan also have their messengers. Don't forget. Praise God. God has messengers. Satan also has its messengers. Remember the other day the Bible said for many are called, but few are chosen. So there are chosen ones and chosen vessels in the midst of the called vessels. Praise God. So he is the mouth by which God speaks to mankind. Jeremiah 1:19, Isaiah 51, verse 16. And hence, what the prophet says is not of man, but of God. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. And 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. Praise God. And also compare the book of Hebrews. Compare the book of Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7. Praise God. The book of Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7, and also the book of Acts chapter 4, verse 25 and verse 28 down to 25. Acts chapter 4, verse 25 and verse 28 to 25. Praise God. I go ahead. I know I'm a little bit fast, but if you need the video, it's going to be made available for you, or you go back to Facebook and rewatch. Praise God again. And also going further, prophets were the immediate organs of God for the communication of his mind and will to man. They were the immediate organs of God for the communication of his mind, of God's mind, what God has in his mind. You know, now this kind of prophet has to do with the Old Testament. Praise God. Am I communicating? Now, based on this particular, he said, prophets were the immediate organs of God. The word were, now I'm talking about at this time, the Old Testament prophets. They were the immediate organs of communication of God, of the mind of God and the will of God to men. Meaning in the Old Testament, there were no move of the Holy Spirit there. Praise God. So the means of communicating with mankind was translated through prophets. And in the Old Testament, they were called seers. Hallelujah. And you can see that also in Deuteronomy 18:18. Going further, the whole word of God may be in his general sense be spoken of as prophetic. Everything and every word of God in its general sense is seen and spoken as prophetic, inasmuch as it was written by men who received the revelation they communicated from God, no matter what its nature might be. They received a communication as it is communicated from God unto them, no matter what the nature of the communication might be. The foretelling, you know, I told you about something about foretelling and foretelling. Foretelling is diviners. But when you talk about foretelling, you're talking about the messengers of God. Messengers of God, prophets don't foretell. They foretell. Praise God. Now, the foretelling of future event was not a necessary, but only an incidental part of the prophetic office. The great task assigned to the prophet whom God raised up among the people was to, number one, correct moral and religious abuses. You could see that from all the Hebrew prophets in the Bible. What they did was they rebuke and they spoke against religious abuses. Praise God. Number two, to proclaim the great moral and religious truth, which are connected with the character of God. These are the duties, what a prophet is, who a prophet is, and which lies at the foundation of his government. Hallelujah. I've taken my time to break down and to make us understand the definition of a prophet. Who a prophet is. A prophet is not just one that you go to and ask him to pray for you and he starts prophesying upon you. No, this man or this woman, as the case may be, as a prophetess, is also a messenger, a mouthpiece of God, God's own representative here on earth as it concerns the affairs of mankind, not just believers. Not just believers. And the other day, we remember when Jesus was sending his disciples out to go out to pray and to preach the gospel, the Bible said Jesus said to his disciples, he said to them, he said, look, any city, any house that you go in and you are welcomed and you are appreciated, He said, let the blessings that follow you dwell there. He said, sit down there, eat with them, and bless them, and share the word with them. But he said, any city that rejects you, he said, shake the dust of that city off your foot. For what? For a witness. For a witness. What do you think that scripture is trying to connect? It's trying to connect that rejecting the messenger of God is rejecting God. And there are consequences when you reject the messengers of God. You've seen from the time of old, you know, from Genesis down to Revelation, how when men accept messengers of God, it simply means that they have accepted God into that particular city and into that particular community. So prophets are agents of prophets. Prophets are agents of prophets. They are there to tell you and to guide you. The word guide. They are there to guide you into the mind of God concerning situations as they need be. So now we are looking at the scope of the curse of the prophet. Being a man, if you dealing with God and could do certain things, you know, and it could bring back some kind of, unhealthy response, you know, from the heavenlies, from God, then it simply means that, what do you think when it concerns God's own representative here on earth? So as we dig deep into this particular study, I want you to look at it from the aspect. Look at it from the aspect of truth. Praise God. And the curse of prophets is provoked when you mock him. Number one, the curse of the prophet is provoked when you mock the prophets. When you mock the prophets. Sometimes, you know, God could send a man your way. And maybe what you are expecting is him to come and prophesy to you and tell you, oh, you see, you are actually winning a jackpot. I mean, I've actually prayed with people, in the course of praying for them, for their soul, they have asked me that, Pastor, you see, the prayer I want is the prayer of, I want to win the lottery. Now you can imagine how drifted they have become. You can imagine how way off they are with God. They see God and his messenger as an obvious spirit and the messenger of obvious. They see the pastor as messenger of obvious. Praise God. And Obia is a familiar spirit. It's a demonic spirit. And when people are too used to visiting Obia, when they come into the church also, they respond to the prophet as an Obia messenger. Hallelujah. So when you mock the prophet, it brings the curse of the prophet. One thing I tell people, I say, look, be very careful. Be very careful when you are dealing with a man, not just a man of God, not just a pastor, not just an evangelist, not just an apostle, but if that man has a prophetic mandate over his head, be very careful how you deal with him, even in secret and in open. I am not saying this to mean that, oh, no, see, I'm just going to tell you the way it is. Just be very careful whether you speak to him in the open or in the secret, or you speak about him in the open or in the secret. You have to be very careful how you relate with him. Because when an ambassador of a country is in a foreign land, that ambassador is treated just as the president of that foreign country should be treated. So when God sent his messengers to you, the kind of reference you give is not because of the man. No, it is because of the God behind the man. I repeat, It is not because of the man. It is the God behind the man. It is him that has sent him that you are referencing and honoring. It is the oil upon his head that you are honoring. You know, because Satan has put it in the hearts of the children of this generation that when you honor your prophet, it simply means you are giving him the place of God. That is a lie from the pit of hell. You are not honoring, just honoring the man per se as flesh and blood, but you are honoring the God that have sent him. And when you honor the God that have sent him, anything that man speak over your life will come to pass speedily. The problem we are facing and that many believers are having some delays, even when prayers are prayed for them, is because they think that they have become so smart. They know the scripture now. So you see this familiarity happening in the body of Christ. Your pastor cannot be your friend. Hello? You can't relate to your pastor or your prophet as your friend. When you relate to him casually, you cannot be blessed. According to the definition I've given to you, all the scriptures I've given to you, when you read them, you will have broader understanding of what I'm talking about. You cannot relate with your prophet as you're relating with your friend or your colleague at work. Your prophet is not to be seen as just a regular brethren in the church. Praise God. You don't generalizely, address the man of God. You have to give him that reverence. You have to give him that honor. The Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due. Don't take it away from them because you feel like after all, I got some money more than him. After all, I am more educated than him. Then when you speak that way, then he will show you that there is something that is bigger than money. There is something that is bigger than education. There is something that is bigger than certificates. Praise God. There is something called the anointing and the ability of a prophet that he can use his mouth and shut down the whole economy. The other day, when the man called Elijah was tested, praise God. When the man called Elijah was tested, the Bible says, after dealing with the prophets of Baal, he opened his mouth and shut the heavens. And it wasn't God that said to him to do that. The Bible says he declared and said, by my word, by my word. So there is a word of a prophet also. God does not just anoint the right hand of a man and not anoint his left hand. God does not just anoint the eyes of a man and not anoint his mouth. When the anointing of God come upon a man, it touches it. It's all about him. Even to the clothes he puts on is anointed. So it's not something you toy with. Even to the bed that he sleeps on is anointed. I heard about a testimony about a man of God that many times years ago, he was in a city to preach, and he tried to lodge into a particular hotel, and he found out that a notable man of God with so much anointing had lodged in that hotel. You know what he did? He requested for the room of that man. He said, I will have that room, even though it's so expensive, I will have it. I want to be in there in that room. What is he trying to do? He's trying to create a contact with the anointing that the man carries. So looking at the whole thing about a prophet, a messenger, when they come in with a message, I've been mocked many times. Praise God. By even unbelievers and believers them all. When you mock a prophet, he may not look like one that has eaten very well. But forget about his appearance. Look and listen to what he's saying. Don't judge him via the kind of shoes or the kind of cars he's driving. His car may be a push and start car. The type that before the car starts, everybody had to join their hand to push the car and have started. Oh, no problem. But the message he is carrying can guarantee you a place of having even a greater car than what he has. So one of the curse of it is when you reject and mock him. Praise God. And an example of such mockery, we can find out in the book of 2 Kings chapter 2. Let's open our Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings 2. Second Kings chapter 2, we're going to be looking at 23 to 25. Praise God. And verse 23, verse 23 says, and he went up from thence unto Bethel, and as he was going up by the way, there came fought little children out of the city and mocked him and said unto him, go up, thou bald head. Go up, thou bald head. Verse 24. And he turned back and looked on them and cursed them in the name of the Lord. He cursed them in the name of the Lord. And there came forth two she-bears out of the wood, and there 42 children of them. Are you seeing that? The curse of the prophet. No matter what you believe in, do not mock any man that comes to you in the name of God. Do not mock any man that comes to you in the name of God. The Bible said that on this particular day, that Elijah was on his own. And 42 kids came out and started mocking him. Oh, look at your head. You know, you're a bald-headed man. And I believe they pushed him and pushed him. See, let me tell you. Every man has a breaking point. Every man has a breaking point, spiritually or physically. That's why we pray for the grace of endurance, to endure certain things. If you provoke a curse upon yourself, you will have that curse. And the person that cursed you won't be blamed for it. Why? Remember the scripture. A curse without a cause shall not come to pass. But if there is a cause for it, then it shall stay. That is scripture. Costless shall not stand. So on this particular occasion, the man of God turned around and cursed them. You are cursed in the name of the Lord. And there come two she-bears and destroyed and killed 42 kids. Hallelujah. Secondly, do not mock prophecy. The curse of the prophet can come because people mock prophecies. Prophecies are words that come from God through his servant, the prophet. If the prophecy does not make sense to you, please go back to God in prayers. It's like, the prophet of God, you know, tells you a thing and you don't look like it. It is not for you to tell him, prophet, it seems like you're not seeing very well. You need to go use hypo and wash your eyes very well. You need to use bleach and wash your face very well so you will see properly. You know, I've been told that many times. Yeah. And finally, these same persons that say, I need to go wash my face very well, still return back to tell me what you said was true. So it brings a curse. You know why? Because when a message is given to you, the Bible indeed says that you should judge it, not the prophet. Judge the spirit. Judge the spirit, not the carrier of the message. You see where the contradiction is coming from? But we move from judging the message and start judging the person. This man of God is a fake. You are not of God. That's not the right thing to do. When you mock prophecies, it could keep you in the place of stagnation. If a prophecy should come now and say, out of you shall come the next prime minister of Canada, you will first of all want to remind the prophet of where you're coming from. Prophet, you know that I am the least of them all in the tribe of Benjamin. I am not even in my family. Nobody regards me. So there is no need. It was because of mockery that the husband of Elizabeth was caused to be deaf and dumb. So be very careful how you respond. What did Mary say? Mary said, be it unto me according to thy word. Not to come and start, trying to make sense. Certain prophecies does not make sense. I agree with you. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't look like you. And I tell you this, if prophecy looks like you, if prophecy from God looks like you, then it's not from God. Many times when prophecy comes from God, it doesn't have anything to look like what you look like today. It talks about your future, the great things that will be happening. Mary was a virgin for crying out loud. Mary was a virgin for crying out loud. And you find out that everything that she was doing. You know, her activities as of that time does not relate at all to what the prophecy was saying to her. She was a virgin. How are you going to be giving a prophecy to a virgin girl that, look, you're going to have a child when she has not been with any man? It doesn't make sense. And to cram it all, the angel went ahead, was saying to her, I said, look, you will give birth to the Messiah. You know that Messiah that the book of the prophets has been talking about? Yes, you, Mary, the least of them all, you will give birth to that particular child. Mary never mocked the prophecy. She only asked for clarity. My Lord, how could that be? Seeing that I've never been with a man. And the Holy Spirit said to her, I said, look, it's not of your duty. The Holy Spirit shall come upon you and you will be filled with the Holy Spirit. Praise God. So do not mock prophecies. Number three, in 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 19, 2 Kings 7, verse 19. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 19. God, I give you praise. 7, verse 19, chapter 7. Verse 19, then the 20. And that Lord answered the man of God and said, now behold, if the Lord should make windows in heaven, might such a thing be? And he said, behold, thou shalt see it. Are you seeing the curse of the prophet there? He said, thou shalt see it with thy eyes. But I am putting a limitation on you from today that you shall not eat thereof. You will not taste of it. You will see it. You will not taste of it. You will see it. You will not taste of it. How can I see a breakthrough and I will not taste of the breakthrough? How can I come to the place of everybody rejoicing? And as of that time is when the doctors are telling me I am being diagnosed with cancer. What a forbidding thing. All this while I was poor and needy. I never had money. All this while I was broke. There was no cancer. Suddenly, now I am rich, I am blessed, and I want to use my life and walk in the things of God and touch the lives of men. Suddenly now I am being told that I have a terminal disease. Now that is a curse of limitation. Because the commander here, they call him the commissioner for agriculture. He is a very good scientific man. He understands biology very well. He understands the growth of plants. He understands. He stopped. That's why I said to you that when you are walking in the church or you are walking close to a man of God, when he starts speaking faith, please drop your knowledge-based theories. Drop it and join him in line with faith. Because in the scripture and in faith speaking, we don't take note of what is at hand. The prophet spoke and declared that by this time tomorrow, a portion of bread will be sold for $1. This is a country that has been in starvation for a very long time. People were starving to the extent that women started eating up their own children, burning them, killing them, and eating them up. The spirit of the spirit of carnivorous activity entered into the people, and they started eating themselves up. And out of necessity, the prophet of God declared, "By go tell the king, by this time tomorrow." Listen, let me tell you: do not underrate prophecy. Do not mock prophecy. Do not mock the message of God. Because as you do that, you have placed upon yourself the ability to see it, but not to taste of it. The prophet said, by this time tomorrow, go tell the king that a portion of bread shall be sold for $1. And the commissioner for agriculture said in his heart openly that it is impossible. Ha, my God. He said, it is impossible. Even if God, he now used the terminology that I believe provoked the ancient of days. He said, even if this God that made the heavens and the earth and sustained the heavens without a pillar, even this God that causes water to come out of the rock without a source. He said, even if this God opened the windows of heaven, that it shall not be and it cannot be. Yeah. And I love what the prophet did. You see those kind of people? You tell them, let them know that they will be used as an example for people not to mock the prophecies of God. And the prophet said to him, okay, I am not here to banter words with you, but I'm here to let you know that you will see it with your eyes that it has happened. But when the time comes for you to eat of it, you will die. And verse 20, and so it fell out unto him, for the people trod upon him in the gates, and he died. So when the abundance started raining down, you see, let me tell you, those that say that you will not eat and the Lord cannot bless you, when God starts blessing you, your breakthrough will break their hearts. that amen is suffering from Kwasoko. I say your breakthrough will give them heart attack. There are many persons that have looked you and they've written you off. When I mean written off, they've even used eraser to erase your name from those that can be blessed. But never mind. You serve a God that has the ability to write and erase, to correct and to institute. Am I communicating with somebody? That God is so powerful that he can give you what no man has ever believed that you can have. And that is the kind of faith we in the Dunamis Palace we operate on. Am I talking to somebody? We believe that without nothing we have in us, we can achieve anything at all. As long as we have God by our side, not man, not the president, not the minister, not the prime minister, not the governor, nobody but God. One with God, the Bible says, is majority. One with God is majority. That's why each time, you know, even if I have certain presence around me, I still want to go to the heartbeats of Baba God and ask Baba God and say, what are you saying? I've heard from everybody, but I've not heard from you. What are you saying? Because I know you have the final say. If you build your life and build your character, you know, based on that, you will understand that God ruleth in the affairs of man and giveth it to whosoever he willeth. That is what King Nebuchadnezzar did not understand. God was blessing him and he thought that it was just happening because he is king. Who are you, King Nebuchadnezzar? Who are you? Who do you think you are? And on that day, he appeared at the top of his castle and said, look at what my hand, King Nebuchadnezzar, look at what I have built. Look at the beautiful cities that I have created with my hands. And on that same day, an angel was dispatched from heaven and said to him, Nebuchadnezzar, you have been weighed in the balance and you'll be found wanting. He said, from this day, you will descend low and eat as an animal. You will become an animal and eat from the grass until you understand that the King of Kings ruleth in the affairs of man and giveth it to whosoever he willeth. And I don't need to expatiate so much on that story. Of course, you know that Nebuchadnezzar was turned into an ape. And the Jew beat him day and night until he lifted up his voice and said, now I know that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, he ruleth in the affairs of man. All this happened when people don't acknowledge God in their success. You think it's because you could run? You think because you could drive mines? You think because you could do things? No, child of God, it's not because you can do it. Of course, you need to be alive to be able to do that. What if God should turn from you the fan of life? The breath of life is taken from you. And the other day, the Bible said, oh, you foolish man, he said, thy soul shall be required of thee tonight. May we not come to that place in destiny and in our life when God will say to us that tonight your soul is required of you. Because when we boast of tomorrow without knowing that we commit everything we do and all we are into the hands of God, when we boast like we got what we got by our strength, you know, that's why when you are called upon to give, you start calculating. You know why? Because you think that it is by your strength that what you are called upon to give was given to you. You think that you earned it, so you think that you deserve to keep it. But if you have the understanding that God gave you the ability to make wealth, God gave you the ability to have what you have, when God calls upon you to release that he has given to you, because you know that he is the one that has everything that you will ever need, when you have that understanding to release it back unto him, then you know at that point that he ruleth in your affairs. There are many of us that God is not ruling in our affairs at all. God is not ruling our affairs. We are our affairs ministers. Yes. Only you are the president of your life. Only you are the governor, you are the citizen, you are the commissioner, you are the finance minister, you are everything, you are the parliament of your life, everything, you own it. But one day, if you are that kind of person, one day, you will never know list, the list of days. You will never understand that God will say to you, oh, you fool, tonight your soul will be required of you. Hallelujah. Praise God. And we go further. Somebody say, go further. Can I hear you say, go further? So we understand that based on 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 19 down to 20, that it is a curse for you to mock the word of a prophet. One, do not mock him as a prophet. Two, do not mock his word. Praise God, because his word is God's word. Listen. I don't know, maybe you understand this or you don't understand, but let me try to break it to the lowest fragments. Now, as a representative of your country, you may be from the Caribbean, Africa, wherever it is, and Asia, but as a representative, you know, of an ambassador of your country, it is not all decisions you take that you have to consult with the president of your country. Do you know that? They kept you in that capacity because they know you are able to make the right decisions and the right deal for your country. So it simply says and means that whatsoever you agree upon, your country as a whole has agreed. That's why the Bible said that whatsoever you allow here on earth, heaven as your country has accepted. And whatsoever you disallow here on earth, your country back home, being heaven, the kingdom of God, we disagree with it. Why? Because they say Kevin has disagreed with it. So as God, me being God that reigns supreme, I have also disagreed with it. And when they ask him, but God, you know that Kevin is just a man. He will tell them, yes, but I sent him there to represent me. So he is my representative here on earth. And that's why the Bible said that touch not my anointed. Why? Because every ambassador has some level of secret service that goes with them. And our secret services are angels. As a believer, your secret service that goes with you, though unseen secret services, they are angels, warring angels that move around with you. So any man that stretch forth their tongue or their teeth or nose or eyes or whatever and touch you in a way that is not pleasing to God, they will be arrested. Praise God. That's why I pray the prayer always. And I'm going to tell you that prayer. When I pray, I say, when you touch me, oh Lord, anyone that touched me by mistake should die by correction. Then you understand what I'm saying. They touch me by mistake, knowingly or unknowingly. Your correction may not be the type you like. Praise God. Just as I stay on my lane and speak what God wants me to speak, either you like to hear it or please take the back door. But don't stand in opposition. Because when you stand in opposition, there are consequences that comes. Whether you are standing in opposition inside of your room with the sheet covered on your head or your blanket covered on your head, hello, God sees you there. There is no way you can hide from him. And the thoughts of your heart, listen, the thoughts of your heart echoes in heaven. The thoughts of your heart echoes in heaven. That's why I encourage people. I say, look, if you think that serving in a church is not your thing, step out. Step out. Step out. Instead of being in opposition with the church and with the style that God has put in place, step out. Because you can't be in opposition with God and you win. No. Step out. Whether you agree with it, or you don't agree with it, it is not for you to agree with it. It's for you to follow with it. And the question is, so you want accountability. The accountability is done to God from the man of God. God demands accountability. The book of Ezekiel stated it so clear that as a prophet, if God has not asked you to speak anything, you speak about it. He said, you are damned for destruction. You are going to face damnation. So that's why Jesus said, who are you to judge another man's servant? Praise God. So we go ahead. Number four, am I right? Number four, right? Yes or no? Good. Number four, Isaiah, the book of Isaiah 28. Isaiah 28. The curse of the prophets. Isaiah 28, verse 21, down to 22. Isaiah 28, 21, down to 22. So this particular verse, I'm gonna be wanting us to read from the Amplified, so we can get it in clear understanding what we're looking at. Isaiah 28. So turn to, if you have Amplified Bible, please turn to that. 28 verse 21. Verse 21 down to 22. Praise God. So I read. Ready? Good. For the Lord will rise up as Mount Perazim. He will be stirred up as in the valley of Gibeon to do his work, his unusual and incredible work, and to accomplish his work, his extraordinary work. And what was that? Verse 22. Now, do not carry on as scoffers. So number four, do not mock the things you hear in the church or from a servant of God. Do not mock the things you hear in the church or from a prophet or a servant of God. Don't mock it. Because there are many scoffers today. Yeah, there are many people that are mocking the things of God. And he said, now do not carry on as scoffers, or the bands which bind you will be made stronger. Hello, watch this. Don't carry on as scoffers, or the chain which is chaining you will be what? Stronger. You know, it amazes me how someone needs help, spiritual help, and the person is brought to church or before a servant of God, and this very person that is asking for one blessing or the other, some are asking to be free from the chains that has been chaining them for decades. You know, some are asking the Lord for blessings. It could range from anything, financial blessing, spiritual blessing, fruit of the womb, whatever it is. And you'll be amazed that this same person will be mocking the things of God. And the scripture is saying here, is that, look, do not do that, because when you do that, whatsoever that is binding you, holding you down, will be what? Stronger. You didn't hear that from me. It's in your Bible. Will be stronger. No wonder when you are praying for somebody to be blessed. That's why, personally, let me just say this. When I'm praying for someone concerning a particular thing, and we have prayed and prayed and prayed for too long, you know what I will do? I back out. And I stop praying and start counseling. Because many times this person may be in ignorantly be doing things that is withholding their blessings from coming. withholding God from blessing. So wisdom demands that God is not a man that he should lie. If the Bible has said, seek the kingdom of God, you will find it. If the Bible has said, call upon me and I will answer. If God has said, if you ask in prayers, I will give it to you. Then you have been praying. Something has not been happening. Child of God, check your lifestyle. You are binding yourself with chains and fetters of irons the more. Look at it. Say, or the bands which bind you will be made stronger. For I have heard from the Lord God of hosts a decree, a decisive destruction on all the earth. Take note of that. If you forget every other scripture, please don't forget this one. Don't forget it. You do not ask from God and at the same time you are attacking the kingdom. Opposition is opposition. There is no reasonable opposition. If you are in opposition, you are in opposition. And if you are pro-church, you are pro-church. If you are pro the things in your church, you are pro the things of church. So you cannot stand in the middle. And anytime you hear people say, oh, you see, I am a middle man. Hello, nobody asks you to be there. Get out of that place, quick. You are not, there is no middleman ministry. Any middleman ministry is a confused ministry that has nothing to reckon with. And it's a ministry of betrayers. Each time you see a person, you say, look, you see, I am not against the devil. And at the same time also, I am not saying that all that God has done in the scriptures is right. I am just middle. Who are you? Middle woman. God have mercy. You can't be a middleman. This is not a place for politics. Middle believer. You see black, you are calling it white. When they ask you why, you say, see, I don't want them to feel bad. Look at you. No wonder your prayers have not been answered. Haven't you read that he that covereth his sins shall not prosper? When you see evil, you are now trying to modernize it. You see, when the people hear it, they will be angry. What is your business with when the people hear it? Did God send you to preach what the people will like or what he wants them to hear? That's why in this ministry, if you are not ready for truth, again, once again, excuse yourself. Praise God. Because there is no truth to the truthers. Truth is truth. And there is no small truth and big truth. Truth is what? Truth. Can I get your amen, by the way? Praise God. Number 6. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 20. 1 Thessalonians 5:20. If you are in Amplify also, that is good. If you're in the Amplify version also, that is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:20. We are almost there. Praise God. Don't get tired now on me. Amen. Are you tired? Don't get tired. Don't get tired. When truth is coming, you won't even know. Praise God. Praise God. When we preach truth, you won't even know that the time is fast gone. Yeah, because you're eating healthy food. Yes, praise God. And I'm personally speaking here, I am being blessed too. Everything I'm saying to you hits me first. Am I communicating? Yeah, we are all in this together. Amen. Yeah, so 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 20. Now, what does it say? It said, do not scorn or reject gifts of prophecy or prophecy. Ha, praise God. Look at that. Number one, do not scorn, meaning don't mock, or reject gifts of prophecy or prophecies. And in bracket, it says spoken revelations, words of instruction or exhortation or what? Warning. Somebody hold your ears and do it like this with me. Say, warning, be warned. Everything about the scriptures has always been warning ahead of time. That's why the Bible says, he that has ears, let him hear. There are some persons, their ears are big as satellite dish, but they are not hearing. So it's not a function of big ears. Praise God. There are certain big ears that you call them from behind. Immediately they turn and back you. They are gone. They are people that don't hear from behind. Praise God. Those ears are good in the area of gossiping. Those that don't listen to gossips and stuff like that. But I tell you the truth. Don't allow those kind of ears to come into your spiritual life. That your ears are as big as satellite dish. Yet you only hear from the front. Behind you, you don't hear. So someone said to me, you know, Bishop, I'm hearing you. I said, how do you think you hear? So Bishop, my ears are healthy. My eardrums are healthy. Hello? And moreover, I have big ears. And I told him, I said, look, you may have big ears, but you may lack function or ability to hear sound doctrine. So it's not a function of big ears. Also, I was telling somebody, I said, for the fact that you actually have a big head does not mean that you'll be the head of states. Praise God. Big head does not connote head of state. Praise God. For the fact your eyes are big does not mean you see more than every one of us. Praise God. It's a function, it's a spiritual function. So it says, do not scorn or reject gifts of prophecy or prophecies. Spoken revelations. When God reveals something to you, don't mock it. Don't mock it. It's a spoken revelation. I see. I hear. I have the Lord said to me to tell you, do not mock it. The Bible said a lot about scorners. Scoffers. Mockers. Do not allow yourself to fall a victim of it. Have an attitude, a spiritual attitude, like the Virgin Mary. Be it unto me according to your word. It's none of your business to know how the prophecy will come to pass. And it's not for you to go around and be looking for the prophecy yourself. Imagine that the angel has said to Mary, I say, you will have a child. And after 2 months, no child is coming. And Mary start looking for a man that will get her pregnant. Imagine that kind of disaster. Because that's how some of us behave. When prophecy is released to you, you go, you want to mechanize it. And the prophecy said that a man is coming your way. And the next thing you do, every man that you see on the go train or anywhere, you start doing your hair, it's not a function of what you think you carry. No, it's not. When that man comes, even if you carry the whole blanket, cover yourself, he will come to you. You know why? Because he's a man of prophecy. That instruction is coming via prophecy. So you don't need to go and decorate yourself with all the Mary Kay and Silver Kay and all the Kays in life and paint your nails like Jezebel and carry the cloth going. You may even scare the prophecy. You need to change. You may put the angel directing the man into flight. So don't obey prophecy. Follow revelation. Revelational words of instruction. That's why I tell people, I say, when you are being prophesied upon, please, by every means, don't get lost in the spirit and fall. And you know, because when you fall in the spirit, you're not hearing anything. That's why sometimes when I'm prophesying to people, I say to them, Keep quiet. Just listen. Don't be speaking in tongues while I'm prophesying to you. That does not make you more spiritual or more holy. Hello? Not when they are telling you, thus said the Lord, you're come on, you don't need that, because that with this, you know, it wouldn't make you to receive and get the details, people of God. Prophecy is details. You need the details. You need the instruction. You need things that will make you get to the destination that the prophecy is talking about. Not when the prophet is prophesying, you are busy. Oh, Lord, yes, yes, yes. And you are even helping the prophet to prophesy. You know, there are many like that. They're telling you something, you're telling the person, oh, pastor, you know what? You know what? You are cutting off. Jesus. You know what, pastor? Two nights ago, and now the pastor, the prophet, should not keep quiet. So you will not tell. You don't need that. Keep whatever you have to say, keep it to yourself. Stop talking too much. It was this talk here that made the man, even as a servant of God, Zechariah, to lose his hearing and his ability to speak. He lost his ability to speak, but his ears were open anyways. I'm sorry about that. He was able to hear, but he couldn't speak. Why? His tongue was locked up with a big padlock. And his release, that the releasing of that padlock was conditional. The angel said that until the time is right, that's when your mouth will be open. Because I think some of us need to ask for the grace of God, for our mouths to be shut up when God is speaking. Many years ago, God taught me a lesson. I'm not joking. God taught me a lesson. I mean, I will never forget that particular experience. I will never forget that particular experience. God taught me a big lesson. In 1998, then I just received the Holy Ghost baptism in 1996. So, you know, this radical believer mentality, you know, suddenly the Lord baptized me with the gift of prophecy. So when I pray, there is a whole lot happening. You know, and at that time, you know, we as young believers, we believe that anytime we gather to pray, God must speak through one of us. Prophecy must be released, either from me or some other person. Not today that people come around and to pray. They are praying like business tycoons. They are praying like people that don't know that it's a spiritual communication they are doing. They are not even prepared. They are just casually gathering together to fulfill all righteousness. Come on, change. And in one of those meetings, I was praying with my prayer partner. And as we held hands, we were praying. The atmosphere changed. The power of God came down. We could literally feel the presence of Elohim. And suddenly, there was a prophecy. That was the very first time in 1998. I heard the prophecy so clear about me being a word minister, a vessel God will use to preach the word and the gospel all over the world. That was the very first time it came so clear, apart from the time of my birth. And why the lady was, God was speaking through the lady. This is what I did that was so stupid. Now, why the Lord was speaking, I started interjecting. Because many of us, we do it. We are not still when God is speaking. I started interjecting, started asking questions. Why the Lord? And immediately the Lord said to me, son, you be quiet. And let me speak. That was the first time. I didn't say in the dream. I mean, literally heard God rebuke me to learn to be quiet. So if you are among those that have the ministry of interjection during prophecy, go ahead. Even Paul that taught about prophecy said it, that when one is prophesying, every other person should what? Keep what? Quiet. For God is not the author of what? Confusion. So learn to receive instruction or exhortation or warning, because this is where prophecy comes. You see these things I just say now, spoken revelation, words of instruction or exhortation or warning. That's why the scripture says, let him that has ears, let him hear. Yes, if you are sure you have ears, hear what the Spirit is saying. I'm in number six now, right? Or number seven? Six. Good. Six. Awesome. Awesome. I have people following. God bless you. Real, real good. Hallelujah. Now, number six, the curse of the prophet. Number six, the curse of the prophet can also be provoked when you oppose the prophet or his ministry. Or his ministry. Hallelujah. When you oppose the prophet or his ministries. Acts chapter 13, verse 5, then to 11. Acts 13. The book of Acts, chapter 13, verse 5, down to 11. Now I read, when Barnabas and Saul arrived at Salamis, they began to preach the word of God, proclaiming the message of eternal salvation through faith in Christ in the synagogues of the Jews. And they also had John Mark as their assistant. So, you know, being an associate pastor or assistant pastor did not just start with this generation. It has always been there with the early believers. So you see John Mark there being an assistant. Praise God. It's a ministry to be an assistant or an associate pastor. It's not everybody that can do that. It's a ministry of his own to assist, to achieve a vision. Praise God. So verse six says something. He said, when they had traveled through the entire island of Cyprus as far as Paphos, they found a sorcerer, a Jewish false prophet named Bar Jesus. A Jewish false prophet named Bar Jesus. Verse 7. Who was closely associated with the proconsul of the province, Sergius Paulus, an intelligent and sensible man. He called for Barnabas and Saul and wanted to hear the word of God concerning eternal what? Salvation through faith in Christ. Watch what happened. But Elymas the sorcerer, for that is how his name is translated, opposed them, trying to turn the proconsul away from accepting the faith. You see, when you have people that are opposing the ministry, you are preaching to someone, some other person is busy attacking you. That is what this next curse is talking about. Verse 9, but Saul, who was also known as Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, led by him, looked steadily at Elymas. And when he looked steadily at Elymas, what did he say? And said, you, Elymas, who are full of every kind of deceit and every kind of fraud, you son of the devil, enemy of everything that is right and good, Will you never stop perverting the straight path of the Lord? A question. And now watch, the hand of the Lord is on you, and you will be blind. So blind that you will be unable to see the sun for a time. Immediately a mist and darkness fell upon him, and he groped around and seeking people to lead him by the hand. Are you seeing that? When you oppose the ministry of a man, except he doesn't want to speak. Remember, the Bible said, whatsoever you allow, God will allow it too. Except he doesn't want to speak. When you live in opposition and you're opposing the prophet or his ministry, it could be very detrimental. More especially when God has sent him on an errand. Remember, the leader, the councilman needed to hear the gospel. But Elymas was there deceiving the councilman. Just like what is happening today in our dispensation. There are many people responsible to deceive the government of the day and lead them into taking certain decisions against the church. They are there in parliament. They are there to oppose the move of God. They are there to make sure that everything that the gospel is supposed to achieve is frustrated. And such persons may never stop because they are messengers of Satan. I tell you, there are certain persons that, I tell you the truth, they are lost. They are damned for life. So they know that. And that's why they will not withhold any strength they have to come against the church and the messengers of God. It's not everybody that should be your friend. And I tell you, it's not everybody that we listen to your gospel. It's not everybody. There are certain persons you've known in the past, but via experience, you've seen it that these ones are messengers of Satan. Please, store their number as on your phone as messengers of Satan. Yes. So that when they call you, you will see it, you will not pick. This one is a messenger of Satan. Because each time they come in contact with you, the next thing they want to suppress the grace and the anointing, and they want to kill the gospel and kill your ability from winning souls. So the curse of the prophet is against those that oppose the prophet and the ministry of the prophet. Hallelujah. Number eight now. Praise God. Number eight now. Kabalato shitikadaba. Now, number eight, I'm going to sum it into one. It says, all these were placed under curse by a prophet stroke man of God. Now, let's see something in the book of 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 20. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 20. I'm almost rounding up now. Are you there? So he said, among these are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan. This was Paul speaking. Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan, so that they will be disciplined and taught not to blaspheme. These were believers. Believers that blaspheme against the name of the Lord. And also the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul said, I have handed these two over to Satan. That brings us down to the book of Psalm 109. When David was praying, he said, let Satan stand by their right hand side to resist them. And when they are judged, he said, may they not find mercy. All these are scriptural things that many of us take for granted. Can you hand someone over to Satan? Yes. Why? It's there in the scripture. When they have shown every sense of it that they are in opposition, you hand them over to Satan. After all, they are working for Satan. So handing them over to Satan has no big difference. Is it not? Come on, church. Is it not? Yeah, handing them over to Satan has no big difference because right now they are working for Satan. So telling someone, I say, okay, since you're working with Satan, I don't want to disrupt your duties and, you know, your affairs, your as a special assistant to the devil. So therefore, I am totally washing my hands off. That's what that means. I'm washing my hands off from you. You can now romance with the devil very well, as much as you want. May the Lord bless you. Yes. And these things are scriptural. So as believers, don't feel biased when you hear it, because each time you hear it, you don't attack the person saying it. You need to go and ask yourself a question. Am I pro or against? Am I pro-church? Am I pro the activities of God? Or am I against the activities of God? So when you are able to answer those questions, then you know if what the person has said to you is true or is a lie. Am I communicating with somebody? 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14. Kabalada balagadi. Verse 14 says, Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. Mm-hmm. But that is no consign of mine. Are you seeing that? For the Lord will repay him according to his actions. That is no business of mine. For the Lord will repay him according to his actions. What does that mean? Galatians 6:7, do not be deceived, for God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that he shall reap. So people like Alexander the coppersmith are those that are believers, but they are in the work, opposing the work, and causing harm to the body of Christ. Paul said, it's no consign of man, for the Lord will repay him according to his actions. Now, if you go down to verse 15, because this man, Alexander the coppersmith, was a very dangerous man. He is those kind of people that when pastor finish preaching, they will call some members to their house and have special meeting in their house to now discuss what the ministration is all about and discuss, you know, was pastor saying it the right way? Or I think he was not saying it the right way. He was not doing it right. He's just speaking out of it. He's not even spiritual that this Sunday. I don't think that pastor was preaching out of the spirit realm. He was just preaching based on the conversation somebody had with him. That's why he said God spoke to him, but I don't think God spoke to him. That is the work of Alexander the coppersmith, to make the word of God to be non-effect. So causing harm to the prophet, the ministry, and the work of God. So verse 15, Paul went further to say, be on guard against him yourself, because he vigorously opposed our works. So which means he was working tirelessly. He is like a fifth column inside of the work of God, inside of the church, the fifth column of Satan. That's why when you as a church leader, I'm talking to church leaders now, when you find an opposition in the church, eliminate that particular position immediately. Anyone that stands in opposition in the gospel of Jesus, try to limit it, try to stop it, because they don't like you as a person. My dear, you have every audacity to push them aside. Push them aside. Because the more you let them be in the organization and also in the place of leadership, they will use their ability to recruit more satanic agents in the church. And before you know it, your church will be filled with virus and the virus will be more deadlier than that of coronavirus. May God help us. May God help us. Any man stood to oppose Paul, and Paul cursed him. The only weapon, I tell you this now, I find it very difficult to lay a curse. That is me. I find it very difficult. I don't know, but I could be stretched as far as the Lord can carry me by God's special grace. But I find it very difficult to lay curses. But don't see that as an advantage, because you may not have the grace. The grace that I mean, that if you come and test, it may not come the way you are believing. Oh, you see, pastor does not lay curses, so let's launch attack against him. Not my kind of person. Praise God. No. I find it difficult does not mean that I cannot. But I know one thing for sure. I hardly put my knees down to pray about irresponsible things, like somebody opposing me. I know the person has already, is already receiving what they should have. And I keep on going about my duties. But the day I remember to put my foot down and to keep my knees into prayers, and a night, just one night of prayers, then there will be war. Praise God. So believers have been protected by God so much that you can't just come around and mess things up around it. No, the church is too powerful. I started off this series by letting you know that the church is a powerful institution. It's too powerful for anybody, any government to mess up with it. But the challenge I'm having today is that believers in the church does not even see it from that perspective, that they are powerful and dangerous. Number 9 and the last. Are you ready for that? This one is heavy. This one is heavy, and I need you to clean your ears a little bit so you can hear this one and hear it very well, because 75% of believers, I'm not talking about unbelievers, are guilty of this. So be ready. Praise God. Ah, my God. I'm not seeing my pastor. My God, Jesus. Well, it is well. Now, hear this. Number 9, and 9 stands for delivery. The number stands for delivery. This, we want to deliver whatsoever we have been pregnant with now. So number 9, the curse of the prophet can also be provoked by lying to a servant of God. Liars, take notes. The curse of the prophet can also be provoked, not lying to God, lying to a prophet or a servant of God. Pastor, what do you mean? Let's see the book of Acts, chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, and we're going to eat this one after the other. Praise God. My God. Now, verse 1, Acts chapter 5 from verse 1, we're going to be reading down to verse 10. Yeah. Now, a man named Ananias, with his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of property, and with his wife's full knowledge, not half knowledge, with his wife's full knowledge and complicity, he kept back some of the proceeds, bringing only a portion of it and set it at the apostles' feet. Now, somebody may say, after all, pastor, It's their money, it's their landed property. If they decide to sell it and bring some portion of it, is there anything wrong? Yes, there is nothing wrong about it. I agree with everyone that there is nothing wrong about it, but let's go ahead. You will see where they got it wrong. Am I communicating? Now, verse 3. But Peter said to Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and secretly kept back for yourself some of the proceeds from the sale of the land? Now, verse 4, as long as it remained unsold, look at what Peter was saying. He said, as long as it remains unsold, did it not remain your own to do with as you pleased? And after it was sold, was the money not under your control? Why is it that you have conceived this act of hypocrisy and deceit in your heart? Peter said to him, you have not simply lied to people, but to God. You seeing that? Praise God. And hearing these words, Ananias fell down and suddenly died. That's it. And great fear and awe gripped those who heard it. Verse 6. The drama still continued. And the young men in the congregation got up and wrapped up the body and carried it out and buried it. Verse 7 of that scripture. Now, after an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter went further as an elder in the body of Christ and as a minister. Peter asked her, tell me whether you sold your land for so much. And she said, yes, for so what? So much. Verse 9. Then Peter said to her, how could you two have agreed together to put the Spirit of the Lord to the test? Stop testing God. Let me tell you, there are some tests you survive it. There are some tests that you will not survive. Stop putting God to a test. Because lying as regarding the things of God is you testing God and testing the grace that is covering you. Now, Peter went on and said, look, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also. Verse 10, and last, at once she fell down at his feet and died. And the young men came in and found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. Now, this is so dramatic, but so it's a very serious story here. Why would you want to lie to the servant of God? Why would you want to lie to an ambassador, a representative of God? Are you claiming ignorance now that you don't know that whatever or the capacity that he is, that God is the one that sent him there, and God is interested of anything that he says and what he hears, because what he hears from you is God hearing, and what he speaks out of his mouth is God speaking. And I tell you this, many believers are found wanting in this area. There are many that are lies to their life drops from their mouth, lies. Not just lies. Lies drop out of their mouth like seas that flows. Ooh, it just flows out of their belly. The Bible says, out of you shall flow gushers of living water. But there are believers that out of them it flows lies of smelling waters. And the consequences is that you may not die physical death, but things start dying around you. One, your coverage is broken. Number 2, it is possible also it could cause untimely death. Because the book of Acts is the new dispensation you preach about. Am I communicating with somebody? It's the new dispensation we are in now. Remember that Jesus did not die some 300,000 years ago. It's just 2020 years ago that Jesus died. It's a new dispensation. So are you still asking the question if people could drop dead in the church? Yes, it could happen. And may you not be the one that everybody will carry the news about, that after you had lied in the church and you not drop there. You have to be very careful. There are certain spiritual things that you don't take for granted. The Bible said they sold their land. They sold their own property. Sometimes some people do these things to brag. They do these things to brag. So the pastor will look at them as, very, 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 very important personalities in the church. We don't care, more especially in the dynamics part. We don't care what you have or where you're coming from or who you are. We are all there to serve God. So come in humility of heart. Because if you are not humble, we'll cast out the spirit of humility immediately. And it may not come the form and shape you like. Maybe you will roll on the floor and your beautiful clothes will be stained. So you don't need those things. Praise God. So they sold their property. And after they have sold these properties, the husband and wife decided to go and lie to Peter and tell Peter that, look, this is how much we have sold. Why they kept certain portion of it behind? Why lie? It is unnecessary. And Peter asked the husband, Ananias, so why have you allowed the devil to fill your heart? Isn't this property yours? Even though you decide to keep it back, it will still be yours. If you decide also to sell it and keep the whole money to yourself, it is still yours. So why come into the church and stand before us as the servants of God and lie to us that you have sold your land and this is the money? And I tell you, under heaven and lie not, many are operating under severe curse as it stands now. I'm going to share this testimony with you before I pray. There was a son of mine a few years back, a young man that was coming up, a believer. He was among the pastors that was training some years ago. And there was this program in the church. And, the man of God ministering called for a special seat. So this young man, nobody knew that he had such kind of property, And I don't know if maybe whatever was in his mind when he came out. And he came out and took the mic and said he was going to give the church a whole plot of land. Watch this, hear this. And the church rejoiced. And when the church is rejoicing, heaven is rejoicing. Now, when he made that pronouncement, immediately as of that time, that property is no longer his. Good. So he said, I have two plots of land. I'm giving the church a plot. And oil was poured upon him and he was blessed for that reason. So, in that period, the church back then in Nigeria, we were looking for a way to build, something that we're looking for property to build. So we started believing God. I didn't take note about, it was after some months, about 6 months or 7 months down the line, the Lord woke me up one of those days and said, go and ask him, what has he done with that land? And when I made this request and I called him and I asked him, what have you done with the land that you gave to the church? Only to find out that he went back to sell the same land. And I said to him, are you not afraid? A land that the church has gone there and poured anointing oil on it and dedicated it unto the Lord. You went and you sold an accursed thing. You want to bring problem upon us in this church? Even you as a pastor in training? So he went down on his knees. I was so furious. I left him, jumped into my car, and I drove off. Everybody knew that there's going to be a problem. So he started begging, asked some members to come around to beg. My wife was asking that, please, that. I said, it's not about me. No. It's about principles in the scriptures and what will come after it. And after due prayers and everything, you know, he came back and said he's ready to make atonement for what he has done. I said, what are you talking about? He said that he has another land that he's going to give to the church. I said, let me pray about it, because I don't want to get myself involved at this point. I'm not going to arrest you because it is out of your free will. You gave it to the church, and the church has not made any document on it, but the church has gone there to pour an oil. So you are free. You bear your consequences yourself, but let me pray about it. So when I prayed, the Lord said, let him atone with it. And I told him, I said, God has given you a second chance. Show us where the property is. He went and showed the church where the property is. The church poured oil on that land. After a few months, this individual went again and sold that same land. What a catastrophe immunity. Jesus. Hey, my God. Sold the same land again. And I said to him, I said, the heavens has been shut against you from today. It is not of me, it's of God. I said, you have no fear, no regard for the things of God. And you are not worthy to wear the garment of a priest. So you are stripped off from anything at all you think you have. From today, the dew will never fall upon your crops. And as dry as the desert is, that you will see all the days of your life. Till date, as I talk to you, he is roaming around the streets like a madman. These things are serious. You don't need to experience it to tell the testimony. Nobody's asking for you to go and experience it to tell the testimony. We don't need it. So do not even think of it to experience it. Don't even pray to experience it. Curses are real. Anybody that tells you, oh, you are in grace dispensation. I know there are a whole lot of doctrines flying up and down about grace. Grace is there. But grace is not an excuse for you to purposely do evil and want to go under grace and claim asylum. It will not work. It won't work. Because it simply means that you are trying to mock God. You're trying to tell God that he's not wise for him to set up the grace covenant to cover you. You're telling God that God, no, you are not wise. Simply means you're behaving like you're wiser and smarter than God. It simply means that you believe that you can beat the system, the kingdom system. It simply means that you're a fraudulent person that wants to always have your way. A smooth guy. But there are certain things you cannot escape. Just as you cannot escape being under the sun, so it is also you can't escape a curse when it is placed upon you because of your attitudes. The same thing goes to people that tithe and don't tithe accordingly based on how God has blessed them. You're simply telling God that you're a smart man, you're a smart woman. I can beat the system. After all, who sees my paycheck? Nobody. Yes. Of course. Yes, I know I had prayed to God to increase my salary. The Lord has increased it, but I'm still going to be paying the normal tithe because it is Ancient of Days and it changes not. That tithe number does not change. So I don't want to interrupt it. It should just remain that way. Who are you deceiving, child of God? Who do you think you are? You're playing with? You're playing with God that seeth even in the secret? To date, as I talk to you, That young man, nothing is what he immediately that happened. He ran to another church and started carrying Bible and claiming a pastor. It wasn't too long. The curse exposed him to. He ran from there. So there is no place, or there is no place and peace for the wicked. And some time ago, some months back, you know, each time I love him so much, even up to date, I tell you the truth. I love him. And I can categorically say that you know, I told somebody, somebody was talking to me. I asked after him through someone. They told me his present situation. I can't take that curse off him. No. You know why? Because he brought the curse upon himself. It is only him that can break the curse. And through a diligent way and genuine repentance, that curse can be broken. But he cannot go and try to deceive another pastor by saying to the pastor, I don't know what is happening. You know, that's what many believers do. They go and cause so many problems somewhere, do certain things, and they pretend like those things. They don't know about it. They run to a new church, you know, and tell the pastor there, I don't know what is wrong with me. I can't really tell. You are deceiving a pastor. Yes, you can only deceive that pastor because maybe he doesn't have the ability to seek the face of God about you. Because if he has the ability to seek the face of God about you and God reveals to him, he will be able to see that there is a divine curse, not man curse, but a divine curse upon you. Instead of running from pillar to post, why not make amends? Why not make amends? And suddenly, I looked at it and I said to them, I said, if only he will be willing to give me a call. Haven't you read? The Bible says, whosoever sins you retain shall be retained. And whosoever sins you forgive shall be forgiven. I said, if he gives me a call, I can walk with him and let's pray together for God to have mercy. But until that call comes, because the call simply means now I have gone through like Nebuchadnezzar, like an animal that wander in the forest. I have seen it, that I have to return back to where the offense was made. And I have to ask God for forgiveness. So the doctrine of grace, those that are telling you that, no, whatever you have done or whatsoever you have, purposely you have done, you have created pains in the heart of people, resisted the work of God, blasphemed against the Holy Spirit, that no problem, you are covered with grace. That's a lie, child of God. Because when you do all these things you're doing, where are you sowing it? You're sowing to your flesh. And where does the flesh exist? Here on earth. The Bible says, he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap what? Corruption. So your reaping will be here on earth. Your soul is saved. You can die and make heaven. Praise God. But as long as you are here, there are consequences that you will face until you realize it and cut off that particular link by asking God for mercy. So I tell you, child of God, we all come to God, we all come to the house of God, but don't take the things of God for granted. Even your offerings and your tithes are sacred things. You don't choose when to do it or when you don't want to do it. You don't just say, oh, I do it when I feel like. It's not how you feel. Is a must. Obedience. Half obedience is as good as disobedience. You don't disobey God and expect the same God to keep blessing you. And you don't walk against the gospel and still go back to the same God to heal you. You have to make and walk out our salvation with fear and trembling before God. Let's bow our heads and pray. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. You cause the light to shine upon us because you love us. You cause your blessings, O Lord Jehovah, to be upon us because you love us. Lord, we pray, O Lord, that as you have opened our eyes to the curse of the prophet, Lord, we ask, O Lord, that mercy be shown to us. As many of us that have ignorantly stepped into that particular place, ignorantly touched things that we ought not to touch. Lord, I am asking today that as your people come before you and ask for mercy, Lord, have mercy on them. Forgive them, O Lord. Forgive that sister, O Lord, for her tongue has led her into a place of bondage that she can't even explain. Forgive that brother. For his action, O Lord, has led him into a place of near success syndrome. Lord, I pray, Lord, that your grace cover us and your power see us through. Open our eyes and our ears and our thoughts and our memories to be able to understand where we have fallen out of grace. And so we can get up and call upon your name. And so you will answer us, we believe. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen and amen. What a God we serve. Put those hands together to the Lord God Almighty and give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Amen. God is faithful. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. This message today hits me so well. Amen. This message hits me so well. This message hits me so well. Child of God, whatever that is sacred remains sacred. You can't unsacred what God has declared sacred. No matter your thoughts or your thought of theological thought or whatever it is, or your belief system, you cannot unsacred what the Lord has declared to be sacred. And you cannot declare unholy what the Lord has declared holy. It's not about how you judge it. It's about how the Lord sees it. And we give God all the praise. It's time to worship the Lord in our giving. Praise God. Jam those hands together. Hallelujah. It's an honor and a privilege to give unto the Lord. And also, if you are outside this particular area, you're outside Canada, you can go down to our website. Go to our website, www.thedunamispalace.org, and there you can have the ability and the grace to sow a seed, a gift offering, even as we call upon it. And I also want to invite us to join and partner in as regarding our building fund project. You know, if as we pray and as we believe that God is speaking to you to be part and parcel of this. Whether it be $100,000, whether it be $50,000, $1 million, however the Lord has laid in your heart to support us to own our own building, it's of God. So I need you to go down to our giving page also. You can see it there, or if you want to do interact or whatever it is, or you want to contact the church for a special kind of giving, the number is there on our website, and also it's going to be displayed. The church contact number is going to be displayed on Facebook. Please, I welcome you to partner with us, and because we have a whole lot to cover in our community and beyond. So those of us that want to do interact, you can do your interact. Also, those of us outside Canada, you want to do PayPal, you can do paypal.me/thedunamispalace, and you can also give online through our website. Praise God. And if you're ready to sow in that seed, I want you to lift up your hands as we pray. Father, I thank you for the givers. Lord, I thank you for everyone that has decided to give. I pray, oh Lord, that their basket be filled with blessings. Father, Lord, I ask, oh God, that their pockets, oh Lord, never leaked out in the name of Jesus. May their pocket never go dry. May their bank account continually be blessed. May all they do, oh Lord Jehovah, be blessed, and all they lay their hands to do prosper in the name of Jesus. Father, when you have called us, oh Lord Jehovah, in the area of building a house of worship for you, Lord, I pray that those, oh Lord Jehovah, that you have laid in your heart to be part and parcel of this particular project, Father, Lord, I pray that you touch them, Lord, that they will contact this ministry and sow in. We believe in faith that nothing is impossible with God. Lord, I thank you, for we know that all is possible with you, even this project. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody say a believing amen and amen. Jam those hands together to the Lord. I want to say a big God bless you to our Facebook partners, those that are always listening to this message on Facebook. We say God bless you. And those connected on Zoom also, we say God bless you. And I want you to know, on Friday, I am going to be on air. I'm going to be ministering via online with a ministry in California. Praise God. So it is going to be awesome. I tell you, it's going to be awesome. So this program is up, and it is something that God has placed in our hearts. Praise God. So I need you to be part and parcel of it, and I know that it's going to be great. So it's a 5 days visual prayer fest. So the host of it is Reverend Carl Amatoy. So I need you to connect with it. Tomorrow being Friday, you're seeing the time there. So understand the timing of it, and I know that God is going to bless us in the name of Jesus. Connect with this program. And we're going to pray seriously. We're going to look at mountains. We're going to believe God to give us our mountains. You're going to hear the mystery. We're going to demystify mountain experience in this particular ministry, and also things that has to do with you also. Mountain, what does that mountain stands for? So on Friday we're going to demystify them. And if you want to connect on, they don't have Zoom, so you just have to connect on YouTube and also on Facebook. Praise God. And I know that God has something mighty for you. Praise God. So on Sunday also is going to be mighty in the Dunamis Pass. You don't have to miss it. Praise God. Last week Sunday, great reports, great communication. You don't have to miss it. And we pray that you are there. The women ministry is going to be live this Saturday via Zoom. Praise God. Via Zoom. Praise God. And we're going to be having an awesome time with our virtuous women. Praise God. Virtuous women, and it's going to be a time of refreshing. Amen. And I know that as a woman or as a young girl coming up, as a young lady coming up, it is going to be very, very expedient and blissful when you come in and learn certain things scripturally. So even as a wife, you keep being a better wife to your husband. As a young lady, a prospective wife also, you'll be a blissful wife. As a mother, you'll be a good mother to your family and your kids also. So please make it a date. God bless you, real good. And I want you to know that you are blessed in all you do. And every connection that God has placed you on, you will never be disconnected in the name of Jesus. That amen is not coming like you even want it. Anyway, for those that are saying amen, may you receive it in the name of Jesus. Yeah, man. Praise God. So I give God all the praise, and we see.